Hello everyone! Last week, we began the story of Nathanos, in which we talked about his mortal life, being called to service by SYlvanas, and undergoing the powerful ritual which did empower his body, but also sacrificed the life of his cousin. Nathanos, he felt regret afterwards, but with Gul'dan opening up a gateway for the Legion at the tomb of Sargeras, there was little time to linger on those feelings. We saw the Alliance and Horde teaming up, with Varian leading the Alliance assault, and surprisingly, it wasn't Warchief Vol'jin. Instead, we saw SYlvanas leading the Horde. It was their hope to nip this threat in the butt, but instead, the Legion, it proved to be far too powerful. The Horde was eventually forced to call the retreat after many of the great heroes were brought low. Even Warchief Vol'jin was mortally wounded by the demons, and he decided to pass on the title of Warchief to SYlvanas. Varian in turn, he was forced to sacrifice himself to buy his people the time they needed to escape, and the Horde's retreating, that was seen as a massive betrayal by some amongst the Alliance. It was his son Anduin who took up the mantle of leadership, and with the Legion threat still looming in the distance, it became our job to scour the Broken Isles and gather the Pillars of Creation. With these ancient relics, we should be able to seal up the gateway at the tomb of Sargeras, but it's Nathanos that points us towards the Warchief, who lets us know about another objective as we go into Stormheim.
I think often about our future, hero. My people cannot reproduce. Are we not destined, then, to wither away eventually? No. The Forsaken will never stop fighting. Not while I reign. Not when there are still beings out there with the power to stop death.
There's more power to be found in Stormheim besides the Pillar. The power to create more Valkyr. Seeing how these beings are the ones responsible for keeping her out of hell, and also her means of creating more Forsaken troops, this is, of course, a great prize for SYlvanas. But the Alliance get wind of their plans, and isn't too happy with the Warchief. Ken Greymane, he lost Gil'naeus and his son to the Banshee Queen, while Rogers, she lost her home of Southshore to the Blight, so both of them are very keen on striking out at the Horde, and they do so when the opportunity presents itself.
Damn it! We're sitting ducks out here! Show yourselves, you cowards!
The Alliance will be upon us soon, and we have nowhere to run. Organize our defenses, beginning with the rear. I want bat riders in the air and catapults at the ready.
My queen, your safety must be our first concern. Surely we can leave a few ships behind to...
Do not question me, Nathanos. Now go. Make for the Eternity and bring this hero with you.
Yes, of course. Come along, hero.
Together with Nathanos, we take care of business. We take care of the assaulting Alliance troops. We place some volatile vials aboard their ship, ready to send it down.
Meet me on deck when the vials are in place. There is someone here I want to kill personally.
Monsters! You have no place in this world!
You call us monsters? How rich! Stop holding back, old man! Show us the real you!
Enough!
Ah, there you are!
Our mission is somewhat of a success with the Alliance airship blown out of the sky, but the Banshee Queen is missing and we have to track her down.
We got the Queen into a rowboat, but she didn't want an escort. Told us to stay behind and fight. My guess? She landed somewhere up the coast and continued on foot.
No sign of SYlvanas in the hills. What have we here? That's one of hers, all right.
Our queen has eluded the Alliance, and appears like she doesn't want to be followed. Not by us or anyone else. Her will is her own, and it's not Nathanos' place to question, only to obey. So it is that we continue our mission of proving our worth and gathering this Pillar of Creation. A mission that eventually takes us into Helheim, the domain of Helya. It is there where we find the Warchief again.
Remember our bargain, Banshee. Do not dare cross me.
SYlvanas has made some kind of bargain with Helya, but she doesn't let us in on the specifics. Instead, we're told to find our own way out of Helheim, which we do, of course, and outside, we're sent to Nathanos again, who caught up with the Dark Rangers. They were sent forward, aboard the Oblivion, on a secret mission from Lady SYlvanas herself. Unfortunately, The Alliance again caught wind of our plans, and now Greymane, who has also survived the crash, he is attacking the outpost. This will not stand, of course, so we take out the Worgen assault on our base, we use our catapults, and we place some delicious explosions.
You cannot hide from me!
Now, not even this will be enough to kill the King of the Worgens, as we find out soon enough. Meanwhile, SYlvanas had us prove her worth to gain access into the vault which contained her so desired prize.
Treacherous Banshee! You know not what you are meddling with!
Submit. The Valkyr are mine.
The deal between Helya and SYlvanas, it granted her the use of the Soul Cage, a magical lantern, which she tried to use on Aeir to make her submit. Aeir in turn is a Titan Watcher with the power to create more Valkyr, so by enslaving her, by making her submit, SYlvanas could potentially be kept alive forever, or at the very least, give it the power to create more Valkyr, and by doing so, empower and create more Forsaken, like they had done with Nathanos. Unfortunately, Gen Greymane proved to be very hard to kill, and he shattered not only her lantern, but also her dreams. Now sadly enough, this storyline never really continued in Legion. Instead, it goes back to focusing on the Pillars and the war against the Burning Legion, with the factions only really taking towers from each other, and that's pretty much the end of the faction war. That means that the details of the bargain, what Helya would get in return, that's never really been revealed. But perhaps that will still happen in the future though, since one of the Island Expedition quests that they added with Battle for Azeroth, it does mention Helya making her return after we defeated her in the Trial of Valor raid. Perhaps. But in Legion, the faction war, it definitely took a backseat. Well, heroes, they rose up and they took the battle to the Burning Legion, even going as far as imprisoning the Dark Titan Sargeras. Before they could, the Lord of the Legion pierced the world with his mighty sword, wounding it and the Titan spirit inside. The world now bleeds, with all across its surface Azerite popping up, a powerful resource that will change the face of war in Warcraft forever.
This will change everything.
And while both factions go out to gather as much of the stuff as they can, Nathanos, he informs his queen about what is going on within the Undercity. Her role as Warchief, it has some members of the Horde criticize her for not showing the other races enough attention, while her own people, they say that she's been giving them too much attention, and a void of power has developed in the Undercity. A void that has been filled by the Desolate Council. They're not another putress or anything, they have no intention of seizing power from the Dark Lady, they're just there making sure that there is a governing body to tend to the population's needs. The Forsaken, now resurrected by the Valkyr, resurrected by the Banshee Queen, they're granted free will, which means that they do have the freedom to disagree with the Banshee Queen's choices. She has seen hell and wants to stay alive forever, but some amongst their people began to wonder if they were ever meant to do so. How much should they do? How far should they go just to keep existing? And for what reason? That's the question arising among some of the Forsaken, as well as emotions and memories to the days amongst the living. As crazy it might seem, a meeting between the living and the Forsaken is eventually set up to reunite family members with their lost ones. At first, SYlvanas believes that this ceasefire, it's a mistake. It will only lead to pain for her people. They cannot be human, and to dangle this temptation of reunion with loved ones will result in them growing discontented with who they really are, with being Forsaken. They will deteriorate to heartbroken shells, wanting something that they can never have. She has no wish to see them suffer so, but Nathanos, he argues that she could use this to her advantage. If she would authorize this experience, this reconnection with people that they loved in life, and presented to them as something that she has generously granted, perhaps they would be more amenable to accepting her solution, finding ways to keep the Forsaken as a race from going extinct. It is, after all, only for a single day. Give them this hope, this moment with people that they thought they'd never see again. Then she would hold power to the happiness, at least in this aspect. Or they might decide that they hate the living and be all the more devoted to the Dark Lady. Either way, SYlvanas would win in this situation, and so it was that the Forsaken and humans reunited within the fields. Not all reunions were happy ones, though. Despite a vigorous screening process at the start, some of the living, at the very last moment, they decided that they couldn't go through with this. They left the meeting, breaking what remained of the Forsaken Hearts. They returned to their queen truly desolate. But others, they actually had a fantastic time. So much so that they did not want this moment, they did not want this day to end at all. Amongst the priests overseeing the meeting, there was Kalia Menethil, sister to Arthas Menethil, cloaked and hidden, and she had promised Anduin that she had no intentions of causing trouble, she was just there to keep an eye on the meeting. She had no plans of rallying the Forsaken away from SYlvanas, but when they called to her for help, she stood with them. She rallied those Forsaken, willing to come with them, to abandon their queen and run to the Alliance side. They're defecting, SYlvanas realized, and this would not stand. Her Dark Rangers fly out over the field and they killed all of the Forsaken, even those that tried to run back to their queen. "My queen, what are you doing?" Nathanos asked. SYlvanas heard the shock in her normally calm champion's voice. She chose to overlook it. On the surface, what was unfolding below, the firing of arrows, the screams and pleas of the desolate council as they tasted their last deaths, could seem perplexing and disturbing. "The only thing I can do, and still hang on to my kingdom as it is," she said. "They were defecting. Some were running back here to safety," he replied. "They were," she agreed. "But how much of that was fear? How tempted were they until that point?" She shook her head. "No, Nathanos, I cannot take this risk. The only desolate council members that I trust are the ones who returned to me early on, broken and bitter, truly desolate. All the others, I cannot allow that sentiment, that hope to grow. It is an infection ready to spread. I have to cut it out." Slowly, accepting her words, he nodded. The Warchief was smart and decided not to kill any of the humans at the meeting, only her own people, so that she would not be the one to start a war on this day. Kalia, however, was not a member of the Alliance, so she was shot down, only to be resurrected by Anduin later on, but that's a different story. In essence, the reunion between Forsaken and humans, that was definitely a bust, and we can see that Nathanos, normally so silent and extremely loyal, he was rather shocked at the choices of his queen. Yet the war did not start on that day, because SYlvanas wasn't quite ready yet. They needed some more time to make their plans, to gather Azerite, and figure out how to utilize it. When she did finally feel ready, all she had to do was convince other members of the Horde to go along with it. Amongst them was Sourfang. She explained to him that she wanted to secure peace for the Horde by wiping out their enemy once and for all. Her position as Warchief had already been threatened before within Stormheim, and the Alliance, it was a clear threat to her goal of staying alive for as long as she could. So it was that they made their plans to capture the world she held her seal, to splinter the unity amongst the Alliance. The Alliance would seek vengeance, of course, but they would have citizens hostage. The Alliance would not dare to strike at the Undercity for fear of their people. It would take them years to muster a fleet to even attempt to do so. How would Gilneas respond to the Alliance reclaiming Teldrassil before the home of the Gilneans? Infighting, Anduin in his new role of High King having to deal with a political crisis, the respect that the others give him, it's a courtesy and not an obligation. If the Alliance will not march as one, each nation will then act in its own interest. Each army will return home to protect their lands from the Hordes. One single victory would cripple the Alliance for years, destroy them from within. Then they could strike peace with the individual nations and carve them away from the Alliance, piece by piece. Sourfang eventually sawed her way and agreed with their plans. Now the Alliance, they'd filled Orgrimmar with spies to keep an eye on things, something that they could use to their advantage by having Sourfang and Nathanos fight in public, pretend that they were going to march into Silithus rather than to Darkshore. Their plan actually worked. The Alliance was put on a false trail, and the Horde forces marched towards the home of the Night Elves. To their credit, the Elves did put up a fight. They even forced Nathanos and Sourfang to find an alternate route for their troops, but in the end, they stood little chance against the might of the Hordes. SYlvanas even engaged Malfurion in combat, with Sourfang striking a dishonorable blow in his back. Instead of taking the prize and killing herself, she decided to let the High Overlord finish it, but that would be a choice she would definitely come to regret. It went against the Orc's honor, and he couldn't do it. Empty-handed, he returned to his Warchief, and Nathanos wasn't happy. Horde blood would spill because of his foolish pride, of his foolish choice. But while the two of them, they were already making new plans, were making ready to occupy the tree, SYlvanas gave the order to
burn it.
The Warchief's words cut through Sourfang's thoughts. He stared at her. Burn what? Nathanos looked just as confused. They exchange glances.
Burn it!
Nathanos turned without a word and motioned to the siege crews. It happened fast, faster than Saurfang could comprehend. A troll mage spread fire across the payloads, and with a pull of a lever on half a dozen siege engines, the horde flung death into the air. No, Saurfang whispered. He watched, speechless, as fire arced across the ocean. Every single payload hit its target. Orange flames began to spread across Teldrassil. Silence fell over the hordes. Even the cries of the captured Night Elves vanished. Everyone watched in disbelief. No! Saurfang whispered again, louder. A second volley launched, and death broke the shock that had paralyzed him. No! He roared. Stop firing! Stop! It was too late. The second barrage hit, and within moments, the lower half of the world tree was engulfed in flames. The fire moved as if it were alive, climbing the tree, scrambling towards the city in the height of its branches. Why? Why? Saurfang breathed. He looked again at Nathanos. The Forsaken's eyes were wider than the orc had ever seen. With Melfurion surviving, SYlvanas decided to inflict the wound that his death would have caused in a different way. She decided to burn down Teldrassil and all of them still left inside. This was never part of the original plan, and Saurfang couldn't believe it. They would come for them now, all of them. There was no honor in this, and yet the Horde followed the Warchief into the battle for Lordaeron. Here we see the Alliance forces gathered, as without the hostages in the tree, they were now free to retaliate. But SYlvanas, she's definitely cunning and no easy prey. She might have won several times throughout the battle with her ruthless plans and abilities, be it by killing and resurrecting her own troops, using the Blights, or simply blowing the place up. But the Alliance had Jaina Proudmoore show up just in time to make the difference, as well as Illyria Windrunner, the Void Elves, and Gelbin Mechatork.
Look who joins the fray. Good. I was hoping you'd keep this interesting.
I assure you, Blightcaller, the pleasure is all mine.
Now it's the Horde that has no way of winning the battle. And while Saurfang decides that enough is enough and he can no longer follow SYlvanas' commands, Nathanos remains loyal as ever as she plans her final move.
You know what must be done. Go, my champion.
Now this scene can be seen and interpreted in many different ways, but to me, it looks like Nathanos is not too happy about leaving his queen to the wolves. Yet all the same, he still obeys her command and he gets ready for the explosion and their eventual escape. This then leads us into Battle for Azeroth, where both sides track down new allies for the war efforts. Whereas the Alliance, they target the Kul'tirans. The Horde, they go after the Sandalari. None other than Nathanos leads their mission into Stormwind and the liberation of Prophet Zul and Princess Talanji, daughter to King Rastakhan, who's the leader of the Sandalari. Our mission is a success, despite the Alliance forces trying to stop us. But the princess has no intention of returning to Orgrimmar. Instead, she takes us to her home. She takes us to Zul'Dazar.
It appears the Alliance dogs have lost our scent.
Good, good. Our journey is almost over.
I hope the Warchief's faith is well placed.
She seems very powerful. Certain, in control.
It is an honor to serve my queen.
And serve her he will, as our adventures into Zandalar, it has us help out the princess, with threats from both within and without, securing their allegiance and their troops for the Horde. Meanwhile, Nathanos is ordered by his queen to focus on the war effort and secure footholds within Kul'tiran territory.
Try not to get
my queen.
Is everything in order?
Yes, my lady. The Banshee's Wail is prepared to depart at a moment's notice.
Good. Work with our champion to determine where we will secure a foothold first.
As you command, Warchief.
See it done, and dispatch reports of your progress to me.
We will not fail you. Safe journey, my lady.
Under his guidance, the Horde secures footholds within Tidigard, Drasvar, and Stormsong Valley, gathering a surprising amount of new undead forces to gain information and power. information that eventually leads us to collecting the Abyssal Scepter and stumbling upon the corpse of Derek Proudmore, who's the brother of Jaina Proudmore, died to defend the world against the first Horde invasion. I'm sure that his corpse will be put to good use in the future, but while all of this is going on, Melfior and Enteranda, they took their time to heal and they're ready to retake their lands. Horde heroes are called to Darkshore as the force is stationed there. They're a little bit worried about the dark moon in the sky. The outpost claimed they've yet to be reinforced with the main forces, and suddenly they found themselves outnumbered against the Night Elves. Nathanos wants us to help uncover what exactly has happened, also getting their lumbering operations back in working condition, and also getting them some reinforcements. The Dark Lady has sent him here with the Valkyr Brynja and Signe, a great sign of confidence, knowing how valuable these Valkyrs are to her, and how many she's already lost. With the aid of Brynja, we can raise the slain Night Elves into our service. Those that are unwilling, they're dealt with. The hunt for information, that is done by kicking the crap out of the Night Elf lieutenants. But none of them is really talking, while the warden Scylla Moonwarden, she tracks her every move.
Scamper back to your Banshee Queen. We are coming for you.
As luck would have it, a little confused Wisp shows up, bobbing up and down as if in a daze. It follows us all the way back to camp, where we use some persuasive methods to find out what is going on, to see with our very own eyes that Taranda has gone through a ritual and has now become the Night Warrior. That is why Alun, why the moon turned dark. Quite unsettling, and we'll have to accelerate our plans before we're overrun by these newly invigorated elves.
There is one more asset to acquire. One who resisted and failed. The Dark Lady was very specific in her wishes.
Before SYlvanas gave the order to burn down Teldrassil, she had herself a little chat with a dying Night Elf. The Laren had fought fiercely against the Horde forces, but she would not die. Not without trying to reach SYlvanas, who remembers herself as a fool, trying to stand up against Prince Arvis as her kingdom fell.
Life is pain. Hope fails. Now you understand. Ah, don't grieve. You'll soon join your loved ones.
I grieve for you. You've made life your enemy. And that is a war you'll never win. You can kill us, but you cannot kill hope.
And so, the order to burn down the tree was given, and in her final moments, the Laren cursed the Loon. The elf that dared to grieve for SYlvanas. She's now become a prime target for the Dark Lady, to be brought back in on death.
This is where it ends. You have nowhere else to run. Assault Feridas! Spare me the trouble and die! Soon she will be here and she will tear you to pieces!
My, my, look what we have here. The hunter has become the prey. It's almost a cliche when you think about it.
No, this was not...
What are you waiting for? Finish her!
One of the first choices that we're given while questing. We can either take the kill ourselves and end Syrah's life, or we can refuse to do so, which then, Nathanos, he will just do it himself.
Try not to get yourself... I knew you didn't have it in you.
Where is she?
We will raise the fallen elves into new champions for the Forsaken and the Horde. But this is where the story for both factions comes together, as Taranda tracks down her prey.
Now that we have the preliminaries out of the way, we can begin the ritual.
Blightcaller!
Well, this is inconvenient. Protect the Valkyr!
You will not see another sunrise, monster.
How uncouth for the Queen of the Tree Elves, is it? No, I suppose that won't do. What exactly do you rule over these days?
I am no queen. I am the Kaldorai's vengeance.
You are nothing. Raise them!
Rise,
In the name of SYlvanas, the Banshee Queen, I bestow this gift upon you.
Zero Moon Warden and Alaren. They're raised as a Dark Warden and a Dark Ranger Captain. New forces for the Banshee Queen. With the Valkyrie empowering him, Nathanos is actually able to hold his ground against Rhonda, but she does not stand alone.
Enough!
Any last words, priestess? Soon you will share the fate of your dear friend Syra and the noble Dalaran. Reunions can be so heartwarming.
Shal Kara!
You cannot hide from me forever, elf.
We do not stand alone. Now!
What?
Your end has come.
We require more time. Finish it, Signe. I will handle this.
You are too late. Behold!
You must fight the shadow in your hearts, sisters.
We placed our faith in you.
And you abandoned us! Alun abandoned us!
We have nothing left. We are forsaken.
Never again! Ashthoribas!
No! Dark Lady! I am sorry.
Witch! You shall pay dearly for that. Let's move!
I will hunt them down.
We make her escape, together with Nathanos and his new recruits. But not before Tirana takes out Brinja. That means that SYlvanas now has three Valkyrie remaining of the Pact, with enough power to bring her back. And since in the past, they have shown that it can take multiple Valkyries to bring her back, who knows how many times they can still do it. This was the reason why we saw the Warchief make a deal with Helya in Legion. The power to create more Valkyrie and potentially stay off death forever. This was a big part of the reason why she instigated the war into Darkshore to begin with. To take care of the threat of the Alliance, secure a position as Warchief, and keep herself going for as long as she can to stay out of the realm of torment. But as we know, Nathanos, he wouldn't mind spending eternal damnation if it would be at his queen's side. Like some amongst the Forsaken, those that we've seen in the novel Before the Storm, some amongst them are wondering now how long they should carry on their undead life, and for what reason. This is where Nathanos' story ends for the moment, but I'm sure that he's going to have his role to play within Battle for Azeroth, and it's anyone's guess where the story might take us. In the case of Nathanos, one thing that is definitely clear, he is devoted to the Dark Lady. It was her name that was the first spoken thing to come out of his undead mouth, and whatever she commands, he will do, despite what he himself might think about it. He will follow her orders. And yet, there are some cracks showing here and there. Like, after the ritual with his nephew, the feeling of regret. The choice of gunning down every Forsaken at the meeting. Being hesitant as she gave the command to burn down Teldrassil. Hesitant to leave her side in the Undercity. In the past, I would have 100% connected his fate to whatever might happen to the Dark Lady. But with those cracks, and perhaps a necessary change of leadership amongst the Forsaken, I'm not as convinced as I used to be. I do really wonder how people would respond to Nathanos as the faction leader, considering that he's not exactly a character that's easy to love.
Come along, hero. Speaker of the Horde. If you run now, you may live.
Even the comments on the part 1 video, it clearly showed that Nathanos, he makes an impact and an impression, which I'd say definitely makes him a good character. Not a fun one or a relatable one. Some of you, you might remember some of my rants about him during the streams, but at least you do notice him and he invokes responses, which is always good, considering that he's a character build up within World of Warcraft. I really do wonder though, what the future might bring. By all means, let me know what you think his fate is going to be. Those mysteries within the story of Battle for Azeroth, they are definitely what keep me interested in the story.
For the Horde. For the Dark Lady.
For now though, I hope you're more aware of what Nathanos has done, what the road was that led him to be leading the Horde forces in Battle for Azeroth. And as always, thank you very much for watching everyone. Subscribe if you like my videos, leave a like if you enjoyed this one. And until next time, guys. See ya!